Are you ready to come on? Or?
Very ready.
Are you ready? Okay, alright. Alright, so everybody, just give a warm welcome to Sadiq, and we'll go there.
I just got here 7 hours ago, and I'm actually not convinced that I'm here. Like, I don't believe that I'm here. I actually think that I've fallen asleep on my coach in London, and I'm gonna wake up and realize that I missed my flight. So, let's just pretend that I made it here, and we'll read some stuff. So, some context before we start. Some fun facts about me. My name is not Sadiq. And I didn't know that my name wasn't Sadiq until I was like 17 years old. And I was going to get my driver's license, and my parents were like, oh, you thought that was your real name? That's just a nickname. And they thought it was surprising that I was hurt by that. They were like, you didn't know that. Also, I have a brother that's older than me that was born 2 days after I was born, but in the month, he was 2 days born after me, but died before I was born. And my parents decided to give me his name. And apparently we looked like a lot alike. Sometimes my parents would argue about like which Sadiq was in the photo that they're looking at, which is very eerie for me. So sometimes I feel like I'm two people at once, but also no one. All right, so the stuff that I'm about to read, I was thinking a lot about poetry and a lot about like prose and how it just sounds like someone's reading a poem when they're reading. You know, they use all these like expressive words and like they're like, you know, the nape of her neck and like, and it's like, it gets to the point where you're not listening anymore, or at least for me, it's like, I'm just not listening to you anymore, you know? So I wanted to do something that sounded very candid and sounded like me and not me trying to sound like Baudelaire or Rimbaud or someone. Like, it's 2020, like, you know? So a lot of these are just like Facebook statuses or like stuff that I wrote on the way here, you know? And we'll see how it goes. I dropped this paper into the water, so on the way, some of these words are probably like not even gonna make sense anymore, but let's start. That's my grocery list, that's not a poem. Too Easternized for the West, too Westernized for the East, too black for the white kids, too white for the black kids. Too existential for the jocks, too ambitious for the artists. Not fun enough for my age mates, not experienced enough for my elders. For as long as I can remember, I've been simultaneously too much and not enough for everyone but me. Too intense for that stage in the relationship. Too poor to marry, too boring to date, too hard to love, too charming to hate. Too African for the Americans, too American for the Africans. Simultaneously, too much and not enough. Thank you. So I always vowed that I would never talk about race because I don't believe in it. I mean, understand that it has this societal implication, like society imposes race and gender and all these things on you and make you feel like you have to identify with them, but I always fought against that. I was always just like, it's me, like it's my skin, but it's me, right? But I think it's necessary to be able to observe your environment and to find things that happen to you and share them with people. So I'm just gonna share some thoughts on like, or rather questions that I have about race or whatever. I'm still waiting for someone to tell me what black is. I don't fucking get it. What makes someone black? Is it skin? Why, if it's skin, then is my Indian friend who's darker than me black? Is it being of African descent? Are Aborigines black? What about Algerians and Fulani women with green eyes and white skin? Why do I have to identify with this thing that no one can explain to me? A friend once told me that being black is about strength and humanity that comes from oppression and the ancestral trauma of being in captivity. I didn't have the heart to tell him that my family is practically Northern Nigerian royalty and they're more likely to have sold slaves than to have been slaves, and that my uncle keeps his Rolls Royce in my dad's garage and gives money to NYT and Harvard. This idea that the very attempt to liberate oneself from black oppression is rooted in black oppression dynamics and tactics is insane to me. The only language we have is that of self-abuse, and we use that to feign freedom and liberation. Thank you. Woo. This one, I have a strong feeling that no one that I know has heard these two words put in the same sentence to describe the same person, but I've met this type of person many times, and they're called the feminist racist. The feminist racist. She won't stop looking at me until she finally walks over and says, "Hey, I'm gonna leave my purse here. Don't steal it, okay? Ha ha." I look at her with a blank expression. She gets nervous. It's because you're black, so like, you know the stereotype of like black people stealing things. "Oh, that was a joke," she replied by laughing nervously, and then sits down next to me, uninvited, of course. "I was just joking, you know. Oh, I actually really love black guys. Like, they have the best bodies." Nice. That must have been a lot of work, meeting every black guy on Earth and then cross-referencing their data and DNA with other research from other races, and then coming to the conclusion that black people have the best bodies. Congratulations. She proceeded to go on and on and on. I was interested to see how far she would go, so I let her keep talking. Then she segues into, "I was fucking catcalled by these assholes today. They were Arab." My expression was cold and disassociated and could only be described as ellipses. I turned around and told them, "Oh, you think it's okay to objectify me and harass someone that you don't even know just because she's a woman? Like, who do you think you are? Do you think I'm just gonna turn around and say, 'Oh my God, that's so hot, I wanna fuck you now'?" I let her go on and on and on about feminism and misogyny and how patriarchy is marginalized women, and I let her finish. So which one of those things that you described that happened to you didn't you just do to me? The confusion in her face was visible. What do you mean? Well, you came into my space without introducing yourself, and you proceeded to harass me with microaggressions and pseudo-compliments that are supposed to be jokes, but I didn't find them funny. You proceeded to make these sweeping general comments about black guys, which literally could have come out of a slave owner's mouth. These black men have great bodies, don't they? Do you think these jokes and unwarranted comments you gave me are supposed to make me turn around and say, I want to fuck you? It's so funny. Girls like you amaze me because I don't think you realize that you're actually part of the patriarchy. In fact, you are the grand duchesses of the patriarchy. Your brand of feminism is anger that you can't be the patriarch because you're so close to being a patriarch. She got up and spilled my drink over and told me that I was sexist. Thank you. Insane, and it was the middle of the winter, and I was like dying to be kind of chill right now. I've been getting these messages today from people I haven't spoken to in a while, seeing how I was doing. While flattering, it seemed to be a strange coincidence that so many people simultaneously wanted to know how I was. Soon I realized that it probably had something to do with the cryptic status about Dolores from the Cranberries that I had just posted, and was in no way intended to be about my emotional state. But the more people messaged me, the more I thought about why I posted those lyrics specifically. The truth is, I never admitted this to myself, but I'm always sort of morose. I spend most of my time alone, or as an observer in the world. I walk past these smoky Berlin bars and just marvel at how happy people look, laughing and toasting through the condensation of windows, almost in slow motion, wondering why I never feel that way. The few times that I've been in those bars, I can't help but soberly look out those same windows, wondering why I still feel like a passerby. I don't really know how to let people care about me or to even care about myself. I have more of a fascination with the psyche and what makes people tick than an actual grasp on how to truly express and absorb emotions. I never really talk about my melancholy because I don't acknowledge it, or maybe because I feel like I'm placing an unnecessary burden on people. Even writing this now, I feel embarrassed and I keep almost deleting it because who cares if you're sad, Sadiq? It's literally half of your name. Get over it. But perhaps it's important to face your bad feelings and to let them live outside of you. Or even post them in a long status where people have to click see more to finish it. Maybe it's a good way to tell people that you care about you, that you care about them, even if you're too insecure to show it most of the time out of fear of rejection. Maybe by talking about your feelings and about your melancholy or depression or whatever it is,
can see how lucky you are to know such lovely people who, despite your attempts to alienate yourself, still persist in showing you that love can exist without need, even if it's just in a small gesture. You'll probably cry at this point, and hell, maybe after you take that deep breath that people take after a good cry, you'll feel a sense of hope for people and for yourself, and have a better understanding of what these people in that bar might have understood that you didn't. I didn't expect this. That the only way to achieve true happiness is by sharing your truest, unedited self with others and letting them do the same for you. Thank you. Continue to misunderstand those who consume your ailments like ale. Drink your privileged poison and soak in the perfume of ego while the soul grows mold. Never stand under the understanding who smile through sadness with faces that mirror your left's right. Keep being charmed by the perpetual longing. Keep living on the outskirts. Keep taking from the giver. Is that not why they are there? Take no moment to consider the darkness of lightheartedness, for the world is for you, all of you, journalists and critics. Wash your feet with the blood from spilled hearts, for death wouldn't be so glorious without you. Thank you. I definitely read this one last time I was here. It's called Millennials. And a disclaimer before I start. I am a millennial, so I'm talking about myself also. Like, it's not so much a critique as it is a self-analysis inward and outward. Apathetically awaiting, always at arm's reach, brass bars barricading them. Comfortably in our confines, confidence is complacency, cordially claiming, can't demonize those who dare to dream. Excelling in any endeavor of finding fault or fallacy, forging friction in fact and fiction, gathering grainy gratitude from green-eyed girls hopped up high on hipness, able to instantly induce insanity in my identity. Joyfully jumping between juxtapositions of genes and jealousy. Killers without karma, leaning lazily on their lineage of leisure. Motionless and misanthropic, mindful of their mindlessness, yet not noticing the nuances of their narcissistic, open-minded oppression of others. Poisoned by pale privilege, quenched until queasy by the toxic qualities in abundant quantity. Resting in rhetoric-riddled reason resulting in repeated reluctance. Swiftly swapping sadness for sanctioned safety, telepathically transmitting tyranny through thoughtlessness. Undeniably unable to understand their utter ugliness, vicariously claiming vigor or valor through virtual victories and victimizing vague villains. One wanting to win without waiting or wishing to wander away while remaining xenomonogamous. Yelling yellow-bellied youth, yearning for years, zoning in on the zeniths of zealousness. Thank you.